Hey guys, this is James from Man Tripping and Men Who Blog. We are here on an awesome special edition of the Men Who Blog virtual happy hour. We have not just one, not just two, but we've got actually three different distillers that are represented, because everybody's heard of the Kentucky Bourbon Trail, but there's a Tennessee whiskey trail that is calling my name, and hopefully it's calling your name too. We're going to learn a little bit more about that with a bunch of awesome distillers, but we also have Tom from Bourbon Blog and my co-host, the empresario of spirits, the grand poobah of poo buying, Kevin from Pub Club. So I will let him talk, and take it away, Kevin.
Thank you, James. That's pretty funny. What an introduction. James is vying to be my PR guy and doing a darn good job of it, too. Yeah, the Kepo from pubclub.com. We write about anywhere in the world. You can have a drink in your hand, and I'm absolutely thrilled that we're now featuring my home state, Tennessee, on the Virtual Happy Hour show. And I had no idea, because a few weeks ago, we did the Knox Brew Tours from my hometown of Knoxville, and now it turns out there's a Tennessee Whiskey Trail. I had no idea Tennessee was such a fun state, so maybe I should have hung around there a little while longer. But we got a couple of people from the Tennessee Whiskey Trail on. We've got a couple of distillers, and we have Matt from Franklin, Tennessee Tourism. Franklin, we featured on a show a few weeks ago also. And we also have the French cowboy, Evan Charles, back on the show, Mr. Versatility, the Swiss Army knife of musicians, who is going to join us and play some country music. He's even got a fiddle out. He's going to play a French country song or something on his fiddle. I'm not quite sure, Evan. But so let's go around the horn. And that's Matt from Visit Franklin. I'm just reading. Jeff from the Jack Daniels Distillery, JD. Everyone in Tennessee knows about Jack Daniels. And I know, I've been to University of Tennessee football games, and the kind of the joke is that if you go to a UT football game without any Jack Daniels, somebody will give you some.
the wettest dry campus in America.
I'm gonna use that one. That's hilarious. Yeah. Chris, good to see you from the Tennessee Distillers Guild. There's Evan Charles on the right. Tom Fisher, Mr. BourbonBlog.com, who taught me it is not in bad taste to drink a good whiskey or bourbon with a Coke. So I'm drinking it with a, actually with a Coke right now. I'm drinking, very good. We had Heath on a few weeks ago too, from the H Clark Distillery. He's going to be joined. Oh, there he is. Hey, Heath.
Hey, guys. There we go.
Hey, so he's there too. So we have this.
Oh, you got the bottles. Good.
We got the bottles. I've got the, you know, as I told you on,
I asked Maxie to send those. I'm surprised he didn't drink them all before.
Well, the disappointing part is you sent, you sent James and I bottles, and we were, you know, going to share. So James is kind enough to give me some of your other stuff. But on the way, in the four blocks from his house to my apartment, this is all I got left. The other taste, because it spilled out of the container.
Well, you know what, Kevin? You're going to have to come back over here and get a refill.
I apparently do.
You know, these aren't the kind of things that I really want to share, but because they're so good. But you know what? If you're not going to share some spirits with a friend, then you should just stop
drinking. You're not a friend. Exactly. And Heath, as I told you, I will not drink this out of my University of Alabama tumbler. I'm drinking it out of it was a client I had for a month, actually.
Well, you know, I've got some bad, you know, really, it's one of the big, the sort of discongruent parts about something as iconic as Tennessee and Jack Daniels whiskey in Tennessee, but their master distiller is a graduate of the University of Alabama.
Roll Tide.
There you go.
It almost make you want to drink George Dickel. I'm just going
to I decided to go to the University of Alabama because I like to win.
Oh, exactly what I told the UT folks. And you know what? They can't argue, can they?
Winning beats losing most days.
They cannot argue. But let's start off with Evan first. He's going to run. It's a Bastille Day, and Evan is actually French, so he's doing a Bastille Day show later on today, all in French on his Facebook channel. But Evan, you're going to knock us out with knock our socks off with a fiddle song and a country music song. He's the French cowboy. So let's turn it over to Evan Charles.
Yay! Thanks so much for inviting me once again. So Kevin has been after me to learn some fiddle tunes. I But this tune is a little bit on the fiddle side, and it also it's called I Love Paris. It's an American tune, so yeah. I hope you enjoy it.
That's so cool.
Thanks, wow. Matt. Yeah, it's kind of funny. Violin was my first instrument, and I've been practicing it again. I always kind of regretted not playing it too much anymore. And this particular tune happens to be really more of a fiddle tune than a violin tune. I started out as a classical musician. So that's what I've been working on. But I figured for you now, I'd do, since we're talking about Tennessee whiskey, and as you know, there's a very popular song lately that's called Tennessee Whiskey. So I'm going to sing that for you, if that's okay.
Bring it on.
Hold out your heart.
getting wasted. Cause there's nothing like your love to get me high in your smooth. It's Tennessee whiskey. You're a sweet strawberry wine.
I'll drink to that.
Yeah.
I'll drink some Tennessee whiskey to that.
There you go.
Yes.
So this is the black and tan that I'm drinking right now, which
I owe
Matt a load of thanks, and ultimately, obviously, Heath, I owe you even more thanks. But Matt introduced me to this at a trade show in I feel like it was only last August, right? In Atlanta. So.
Yeah, down in Atlanta.
So that Heath, that was a great choice you did getting him a bottle in hand, because I tell you, many people didn't know where Franklin was before the show, but let me tell you, by the end of the show, Franklin was the place that had the whiskey. So you know, I partook and it built goodwill. So. Cheers to friends, cheers to whiskey, and cheers to being able to hopefully soon make our way back east and enjoy some of it in Tennessee itself.
Cheers.
Go on some of these distillery tours. You know, I mentioned Jeff behind stage that I'd been to the Jack Daniel's distillery once, and it's very, very, you know, here's Jack Daniel's, right? This gigantic producer of whiskey, and you go down there and it's like a little country bumpkin thing. They, you know, their guide was the guy who looked like Junior Sample, you know, from Hee Haw. And he's walking through there and he talks like this. And he's like, you know, you go up here and they get the stuff going down through the charcoal filters. And, you know, a taster, it's his job to taste the stuff, you know, and you're supposed to spit it out. But, you know, if you drink, you know what happens? They make you a tour guide.
I would tell you which tour guide that is, but that sounds like pretty much all of them.
Well, I tell you what, I love it. Then we go in the factory, and it's this old—not old, but it's, you know, certainly not a modern factory. And I'm
built in the 1930s.
These bottles are going around, but I'm like, this isn't Jack Daniels. I mean, come on, the Jack Daniels got to be like huge. And it turns out it's what Gentleman Jack is there on the actual site, but the actual big place is down the street. But I can tell you a quick story, too.
I'll correct you there. Every drop is made in the hollow, but our bottling operation is down the street.
I see.
A single barrel. Single barrel is the thing you see bottled in the hollow.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
All from the same water source, too.
Yep.
It's the Limestone Creek or something like that, right? That
yep, makes it's the Limestone Cave Spring.
Limestone Cave Spring.
Yeah, 56 degrees year round. Perfect on a day like today. It's 91 here.
Oh,
so that's a good day to be standing in the opening of the cave where it feels like an air conditioner blowing in your face.
Well, it is true, right, Jeff? Or at least legend. I'm going to believe it's true that Jack Daniels died trying to get a drink of Jack Daniels.
Well, he was trying to get something out of a safe that he couldn't get open. The safe is still here in the old office. It's
yeah, they have
it's very, very temperamental. It's hard. Even if I gave you the combination, I'm not sure you would know enough to open it because it's just it's very difficult to operate. I forgot what year model it is, but it's got four letters in the combination, but you have to do them in a particular way and hold your mouth right and, you know, then jump in the air and click your heels together and then turn the lever and pray it over.
The mobile Jack Daniels experience. I went through a mobile experience. I think it's an IndyCar race or NASCAR race. And it was pretty cool. It wasn't as good as going to the actual distillery, but it was for guys who never experienced
it. It hopefully gives you a little bit of a teaser, makes you want to come to see Lynchburg in person someday. But yeah, normally that would be headed out for like Sturgis around this time, but there's not going to be much going on for that mobile experience this year.
Sturgis is still happening, though.
It is, but we'll have a few people out there, but not doing what we normally do.
Now, for those of you who aren't familiar with exactly what Tennessee whiskey is versus other stuff, because Keith, your bourbon is bourbon, and the black and tan is this actually a Tennessee whiskey or is this the bourbon in there?
No, ironically, we don't make a Tennessee whiskey. So the black and tan is a malt whiskey, and then we have our traditional bourbon. And so we go do. I'm getting a lot of echo.
Yeah,
is that just me?
Let's see here. Who's echoing?
Now we have to do a little troubleshooting. Pub Club Ashley is backstage, by the way.
It's Jeff that's echoing.
Jeff.
Sorry, Jeff. You're not gonna get to tell us what Tennessee whiskey is. So we'll let the Tennessee whiskey story be told by someone else.
So we do a Tennessee bourbon, and so it's really because I just couldn't manage the charcoal process, and so. Tennessee whiskey is that brand and style of whiskey sort of known the world over that nobody does better than Jack Daniels. And so when we, Chris Tatum's also on the line, he's the president of the Tennessee Distillers Guild. We, as a board, set out about 5 years ago to really do a better job of telling the story of Tennessee whiskey and then also everything else that's going on in the state. You know, it's not just Tennessee whiskey. So we've got, you know, amazing stuff coming out of Jack Daniels and George Dickel. We make a gin, Tatum, those guys at Old Forge, they make a really interesting rum. They do a muscadine gin that's really good. And so we got together a couple of years ago and hosted the nation's departments of agriculture. And we were able to fill the whole bar for that sort of national event.
Welcome home.
With just Tennessee spirits. And so that's really the heart and soul of Disney Whiskey Trail. You've got guys like me trying to figure stuff out for the first time. You've got folks like Chris Tatum doing the same thing up in East Tennessee. And then we've got our legacy distilleries like Jack Daniels that really make it possible for us to do what we're doing. So
I think it's a really good point that Heath makes that, you know, you can go up to the Kentucky Bourbon Trail and you can have a whole bunch of bourbon. It's pretty good stuff. You know, it's cute, but you can come try our trail, which stretches from, you know, Bristol to Memphis, and you can have the number one most recognized brand in the world, Jack Daniels. You can turn around and have H Clark Bourbon, H Clark Black and Tan. And we make everything but scotch and tequila. I have a phrase for why we don't make scotch, but I'm sure this is a PG show, so I won't say it, but I do think...
I don't think it's a PG show.
Oh, I promise
it's definitely
you
a 21-plus show.
Yeah.
I'm the wrong guy to open up that door. I'll just promise you now. So, but in all seriousness, I mean, we do. You have a variety of everything, and guys are out there making, you know, you try some stuff at Short Mountain. amazing stuff. You've got the professor, you know, Bruce Boyko over Nashville Craft, which is downtown urban Nashville. And like he said, we're able to, you know, give people experience, you know, that they're not going to get anywhere else. Seriously, they're not getting anywhere else in the world. From the food around us, to the entertainment, to the liquor, everything else. So,
Tom nearly fell out of his chair when you said, it's okay up in Kentucky. Tom, I don't know if you know this or not, but there's a huge rivalry between Tennessee and Kentucky, particularly East Tennessee. And Chris, I don't know exactly what town you're located in, but you know, those Tennessee folks and Kentucky people do not like each other. So I as a Tennessee, East Tennessee native, knew that he was giving that little jab in there to Kentucky.
Hold up here, Ken. Let's say something. I'm a graduate of the University of Tennessee. Tennessee whiskey is far superior than that shit up north, period. Okay? But the people of Kentucky are good people. I had some of the best times when I live in Lexington. It's okay that they're doing their thing, but it's our turn. We lead the way. We're the number one.
We've told everyone. If you're a runner, yeah, if you are a runner, if you take the Kentucky Bourbon Trail, that's like a 5K. If you come take the Tennessee Whiskey Trail, that is a marathon.
That is
30 stops. It's all whiskey. That's our other thing. Not everybody makes Tennessee whiskey. Some do bourbon, some do gin, some do vodka, but it's all whiskey at the end of the day, so it's a whiskey trail. Yeah. But a great diversity of spirits, and literally you can see the state from Memphis to Bristol and stop at distilleries along the way. It's a great proposition for people.
Yeah, I love what you guys have done. I love the fact that there's so many distilleries. I mean, obviously, when we created bourbonblog.com back 15 years ago, those were really the early days of the Kentucky Bourbon Trail, and it's been fun to watch that grow. But I think it's exciting that there's a place that you can go that there are 30 plus distilleries, and I love it, and I hope that more and more states can really see what it's done for tourism and can grow in it. It's, you know, it's great to see Heath and Chris and Jeff and, you know, all these distilleries that I really enjoy gathered together in one place and growing it for everybody. I think you guys have done such a great job with it.
Well, we appreciate that. I mean, yeah. Jack, you know, Jack Daniels has been a vital part of this from the beginning. You know, we started, there were 15 of us. Like Jeff said, we're up to 32 members, 30 on the trail. And Tom, you know, it's good. Everybody needs a rivalry. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
You know, I wish UT was more of a rivalry for Alabama, but hey. You know, it's okay. You know,
hey, here's the deal. When distilleries compete, consumers win. Remember that statement.
That's a really good statement. I agree with that.
Everybody's got to step up their game, including Jack Daniels. So.
And, you know, I love the fact that you guys are working together, because here in San Diego, the San Diego Brewers Guild, so San Diego has a phenomenal beer scene. It's world class. But when some of the guys started getting bought out and started turning into big guys with money, the Brewers Guild kicked them out. And they were still friends. I mean, you're all, it's a small family. But they stopped actually working together. And I think it's great that Jack Daniels, kind of the king of the hill, is still supporting guys like Keith and Chris. And I have no idea your size, but I mean, I don't think anybody's as big as Jack Daniels is.
So, and it's not just lip service. It's, you know, when I first got started, there was a barrel shortage. And so I couldn't buy barrels. And so it was literally, you know, Jeff called me. He's like, hey, do you need barrels? And so, you know, back 5 or 6 years ago, Jack Daniels made sure everybody in Tennessee had enough barrels to lay down whiskey.
So it's not
just camaraderie and us getting along and doing podcasts together. It's real cooperation.
Although we do appreciate that.
It is. Well, you know, to further add to Heath's point, you know, it's something where both sides have benefited, and the fact that we have the master distiller, you know, Jeff Arnett, you know, he's our board member, and everybody in our guild is one DSP, one vote. There's no big guys, little guys in our group, and you know, we don't differentiate from that. And most other guilds do, or associations do. Kentucky being, you know, the biggest that does that, and so I think that allows for us to be brothers and sisters in the boardroom, or brothers and sisters during our quarterly board meeting, and then we let our marketing companies fight it out. You know, so.
It truly is a gentleman's industry, though. That's one of the great things about working here. Not only is it fun, you can be very creative, innovative, make a lot of different types of things. And you'll see that if you take the Tennessee Whiskey Trail, that not everybody's doing the same thing. Everybody's got their own take on how to do it. But we've got one another's backs. We've kind of said long ago that we feel like a rising tide will lift all ships. We want the trail to be a great experience. So we reach out to distilleries that we've heard people maybe didn't have the best experience and try to help them make it better. Just in the spirit of everybody getting and putting their best foot forward, we try to do that.
Maybe you guys could explain exactly what this whiskey trail is, because,
I think a pub crawl,
but it's not quite that way. And then, Matt, you also, we mentioned on an email this week, that you actually have a bus limo service that will drive people around to certain places in the Franklin area. Maybe you guys can expand on this, what it is, how to get around, so you don't drink and drive and stuff like that.
Well, actually, Kevin, before you start there, and unfortunately, Evan's sideways now.
Evan.
Evan's been drinking a lot. But Evan said he has room for one more song. He has to leave by 2 or 2:15. So,
okay.
Evan, if you're able to get right side up again, do you want to do one more song before you leave?
You stop drinking, Evan.
Well, we not need to stop drinking this day.
Okay, well, or not. But
Evan, come back.
Okay, well. Evan, I hope you have a great show. Make sure everybody that is interested in celebrating Bastille Day, make sure you go visit Evan's Facebook page, facebook.com/Evan Charles Music. He is a great partner of the show. And even though he has to go, I just wanted to make sure that he didn't get left behind. So anyhow, now back to our story.
So what is it?
How do you get on it?
We spent a long and hard, so the Bourbon Trail is a known tourism product that has been very successful for the distillers of Kentucky and the state. And so when we started thinking about how could we connect our disparate distilleries from across 600 and something miles together as a group, we really spent a lot of time thinking about what are the keys to Tennessee culture. And so the cultural cornerstones of Tennessee have always been music. It's always been hospitality. And it's really always been whiskey. So it's a fairly easy story to tell. And so whether you're here to visit, all the distillers at once, which might take a while, or whether you're here to visit the Smoky Mountains and pick up a few while you're in town, or a ball game or a concert, God, please let us have concerts again.
Or a NASCAR race at
please.
Bristol.
Have a race. And so what's really unique about Tennessee is that we are known for whiskey. We produce, some of the best stuff in the world. We also produce some of the best music in the world. So you can come into town and in the state, whether it's Memphis or Bristol or Knoxville or Nashville, and have a good time doing something else. And then come see some world-class distilleries along the way. So you can have a great experience with food, drink, and music, really anywhere in the state. We know nobody does it better than we do.
Yeah. What other state could give you Elvis, Jack, and Dolly?
Anyone that is interested.
No last name needed. Elvis, Dolly, Jack.
Seriously, like anybody who wants to make it in the music industry, I swear it, they go, I want to go to Nashville. I'm going to move to Nashville, Nashville, Nashville. I sing karaoke, but I'm not like going pro or anything.
Yeah.
the level of talent.
James and Kev and Tom, here's something for you. 6.5 million people visited the Tennessee Whiskey Trail last year. Do you know what the numbers were for Kentucky, Tom? Divide by six.
I know it wasn't as big as that. That's amazing what it's done for.
Hey, you're back, Evan.
Evan's back.
It's such a great state.
And he's upright.
The people of Tennessee, I'm only a couple hours from Tennessee where I live. And every time I go through Tennessee, it's been a little while the last few months. But I always say it's really some of the best people in the whole world. I love Tennessee. It's a very special place.
Hey, Evan, do you still have time for one last song? We tried to get you on, but right as I said, and let's get Evan back on, you blinked out. So are you there and are you able to do one last song?
Yeah, I know Jeff and Chris
have one more song.
Well, I know Jeff just has some hard stops, so they may have to take off before Evan gets started.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
I apologize.
Everybody's leaving us?
I apologize. I'm going to have to jump off.
Oh, thanks for joining us.
I feel like I just met you.
Love to do it again.
Bye.
And we'll definitely do it. Just reach out. We'll do it again. Love to do it again. Sorry to jump off.
But drinking it right now. Chris,
before you leave, we have you tagged as the Tennessee Distillers Guild. But I want to make sure that we get a plug in there for your other business or for your business.
Yeah, Old Forge Distillery. Yeah, I mean, that's something real quick, 30 seconds. The guild is made of all of our members. We are a volunteer organization as far as our leadership, our board. Jeff's on the board. Heath's on the board. I'm on the board. And Tom will give me a great plug. Tom is a huge fan of ours, and I love the fact that he pushes for us. So
I love their whiskey. It's great stuff.
We're fortunate. Really so amazing. Old Forge Distillery.
And where are you located?
Thank you.
Oh, where are you located?
Pigeon Forge, Tennessee.
Oh, right up the street from me. Right up the street from me.
Pigeon Forge.
Yeah, Pigeon Forge. Pigeon Forge, Sevierville, where Dolly's from, and then Gatlinburg are all right there together. And so it's all right there together. I believe they're just looking on the map yesterday of the website. There's at least a dozen distilleries right there in Pigeon Forge, Gatlinburg, and Sevierville.
13. We have 13 in the East Tennessee region.
Oh my!
Is what we have in the East Tennessee region, and there's about 12. Jeff Heath in the middle. Is that correct?
12 or 13 in the middle as well.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So I'm originally from West Tennessee. That's unfortunately our lowest area. We don't have many participating distilleries there, but we do have Old Dominic located in Memphis. So if you're down near Bill Street, if you're down in that near Sun Studios, kind of taking the music tour of Memphis, they're not far away. A great group of people. They also have a seat on our board. Their distiller, Alex Castle, great Kentucky girl who saw the light came to Tennessee.
Probably, yeah.
But thanks for joining us. I want to give a quick shout out to the Tennessee song legend, Charlie Daniels, who passed away last week.
May he rest in peace.
He was the biggest UT fan, I think, in the entire history of Tennessee. So shout out to CDB.
Yep. So, cheers.
Yep. Cheers, y'all.
Cheers, guys.
Evan, you going to sing us a song?
Man, let's rock and roll.
Is he frozen?
He's frozen now. He was sideways.
He's either frozen or really confused. There he is.
Evan, are you going to sing? I'm breaking up.
Doing one more song. Is that the plan?
Yes.
Yep.
One more song. Yes.
I'm not sure the audio is going to be sufficient here.
All right, so I'm going to do.
Should I refresh?
Sadly, I do have to go. I'm going to do one more song. This is one of my songs, and it's called "I Could Tell What You're Thinking by the Liquor You're Drinking."
I love all your songs, man.
I can tell what you're thinking by the liquor you're drinking. Every bottle tells a story, and it's no great mystery. You can call me a psychic, we have a touch with the spirits. Yeah, I can tell what you're thinking by the liquor you're drinking. Tequila, your fun party starting right now. Import a microbrew, ready for something new. Domestic beer, down to earth and casual. Manhattan mojito, you're so unusual. Vodka, you're independent, dressed like a designer. Nothing but trouble with Jaegers and shooters. White wine, it starts showing off your knowledge. Red, you're confident, and probably went to college. I can tell what you're thinking by the liquor you're drinking. Every bottle tells a story, and it's no great mystery. You can call me a psychic, we have a touch with the spirits. Yeah, I can tell what you're thinking by the liquor you're drinking. Oh yes, I really can, it's no mystery to me. I majored in boozology. See the islands from your local bar where the Mai Tai turns
hurricane, a pina colada. Scotch, you're the man. White Russian, you're the dude. Cosmo and Zinfandel. Who you trying to fool? Rum, no worries. Martini, so refined. Irish coffee, hot toddy. Way past your bedtime. Long Island iced tea gets you there faster. Water, you're drunk, or the designated driver. I can tell what you're thinking by the liquor you're drinking. Every bottle tells a story, and it's no great mystery. You can call me a psychic, way out of touch with spirits. Yeah, I can tell what you're thinking by the liquor you're drinking. I can tell what you're thinking by the liquor you're drinking. Every bottle tells a story, and it's no great mystery. You can call me a psychic, way out of touch with the spirits. Yeah, I can tell what you're thinking by the liquor you're drinking. Oh, I can tell what you're thinking by the liquor you're drinking.
All right.
Woohoo!
I'm buzzed just thanks after going through all those drinks.
Well, on the show, as always, yeah, that is one of my
I really like the lyrics, Evan.
That's a wonderful, wonderful day, wonderful bachelor day in honor of my native land. I'm a proud naturalized American, but I was born and raised outside. I hope to see you guys again very soon.
Cheers, Evan.
All right, cheers.
Cheers, Evan. Love seeing you.
Thank you.
Cheers, buddy.
Evan's been on the show about as often as James, Ashley, and I.
Seriously, he's like a regular.
Well, now we're down to six. I'm so glad that StreamYard enabled us to do up to 10 people now, because definitely the vibrancy of the show, I think, is better.
Hi, without
having to worry about being able to have in or have not in. So anyhow,
why don't we have Matt? I'm sorry, Jane.
I just want to say, thank you for sending these three awesome bottles. In case you haven't figured out, I'm in love with the black and tan, but I like the other ones as well. But I wanted to see if maybe you can walk us through exactly what we're tasting and where people can find it.
Drinking this one.
What is that?
The rest of it.
Very good.
Actually, killed the whole bottle as soon as you sent it to
me. Oh, I shared it with a friend. I didn't drink it all today.
No, that's good. I wish we could get some to Tom. Tom, you and I met at one of the distiller conventions in Nashville a few years ago.
That's right. We did. Yes. We'll try it again sometime soon. Would love to. Absolutely.
Yeah, I shared it with Gabby. We were sent four bottles, so thank you. And I gave two to her and two to me.
How is Gabby doing? Is she feeling better?
She's slowly feeling better, but bless her heart, she's been going through some rough times. Right?
Wow.
She's a trooper, though. She's gonna make it.
Oh, she'll be fine. She'll be fine.
Good. Yeah.
So, I have faith.
I don't remember what all got sent where, so I'll just sort of start with the black and tan. So,
they're curious about that, by the way.
Yeah, it's kind of a, we say it's a union of British beer and Scotch whiskey traditions. I got to spend a semester of my college years over in England, go to the Sam Smith Brewery, and then a few Scotch distilleries.
Is that and Tom?
Thank you for that, Jim. Thank you.
And so with that whiskey, we make an oatmeal stout ale. So it's basically the distilled Sam Smith's oatmeal stout ale. And so we'll twice distill it, barrel age it in a blend of new and used oak. And so we really wanted to get that big chocolate note on the background of it. So it's an easy drinker.
Definitely.
For folks who like scotch, it's going to feel familiar. It's got that sort of texture that a lot of scotch whiskeys do. But instead of that smoke or peat flavor that some folks don't care for, this has basically chocolate. And that all comes from a chocolate malt. So we're very traditional in our methodology, but the flavor profile is not traditional. It's 100% grain, water, yeast, that's it. And so one of the fun things that we had to learn sort of the hard way was that our friends in Scotland age their whiskey and use casks because it's better for the whiskey. And so we really over-oaked some early black and tan in new casks. And, you know, Tennessee summers are hot. And so we kind of did the oak.
Yeah, they are.
The hard way to really use some of those used barrels.
I have a quick question. Yes. Do people just drink it on the rocks or they mix it with something?
I like it just over on the rocks. If I'm doing sort of my winter cocktail, there's a liqueur out there called Ancho Reyes. It's like a chili liqueur. So
super good.
I take some of that Ancho Reyes and some black and tan and a cocktail cherry. And man, it's like there's a
cocktail cherry.
There's this popsicle shack in Nashville that sells the Mexican style popsicles, and they do like a chocolate cherry chili popsicle.
Is it spicy?
Yeah,
super chili, spicy. Yeah. Like a michelada sort of thing.
Wanted something a little easier, like a black wine, an old fashioned. We've had some really creative mixologists here in Nashville do some fun bucarés with it. So it's pretty more versatile than scotch for cocktail purposes, I think. But it's easy drinking, whether you want to drink it neat on the rocks or mix it up a little bit. It's got a fun flavor profile. You can move around a little bit.
That was so light, and I could just taste the chocolate at the very end of it, but it was not,
expecting that.
Yeah, it was so light. I've never tasted anything like it, actually.
Yeah.
Well, I've never heard of anything like it, right? So I was like, my taste buds weren't ready. I guess it's
really you're going to try one. If you're a craft distiller, you better be good, and then you better be a little off center. So, you know, it doesn't do me any good to try to replicate Lafrague does a good job of making Lafrague. And so, how do we push
the boundaries and stuff?
Yeah.
So anybody who picks up a bottle, I'm not sure if you have distribution or where you would find it normally, but for anybody who does get a bottle, you know, take a sip, take a step back and then take another sip, because the first sip, you're going to sit there and go like, okay, I don't know if I like it because it's not bourbon. It's not scotch. It's not anything that your brain can recognize.
Right.
And just relax and enjoy it. Cause it's definitely one of my favorite whiskeys that I've had. And I've been blessed to have had quite a few.
Had lots of whiskeys. Yeah.
So when we first
rub it in, James.
I've been sharing what I can with you. And
we had a guy come in the shop and, he bought a couple cases of it, which was a big day, especially when you first get open. You're like, oh, this is great. And so he made a point to tell me two or three times that he wasn't going to drink it. And I'm like,
it's for a friend.
I don't really care. You know,
okay. You bought it. Okay.
And so he said he was going to use it to make pie. And I'm like,
what pie?
Whatever, man. And so that summer, four different couples stopped by our distillery and they're like, hey, we were driving along Route 66. We're in Texas. We stopped at this place, had some pie and had your whiskey. So I was like, this has got to be kidding me. So it turned out this guy had a store, like a pie shop, 30 or 40 miles west of Amarillo, and was out there making and selling pies. And at least four people had the
with
pie
your food
from Texas, from not just Texas, from like past Amarillo to Nashville.
Wow, like basically in New Mexico or depending on where they came from.
You need it's more really good with
a long drive.
If you have like an apple
well,
pie,
hell, now I want some pie with this in it. Come on now.
Yeah, they were making a chocolate pecan pie. It was really
good. That would be even better. Yeah.
Pecan, I love it.
Where's Amarillo? You being a Texas girl, where is
it? It's very, very, very west. It's at the top.
It's at the top. Like
the panhandle of Texas. So top west.
I didn't know Route 66 was
there. Cadillac Ranch.
That's where Cadillac Ranch, where I did my first tag. Like, we got spray paint.
Yeah, no, I got a funny story about Cadillac Ranch.
It's a whole bunch of Cadillacs in the sand.
And there's
it's the craziest thing I've ever seen.
There's now a VW bug thing. It's just like that, just down the road too.
Oh, so, they're copycats.
It's not as cool. There's nothing as cool as the original. So I'm standing there in my flip flops. And it was, you know, I mean, in summer, it rains in Texas, and so I didn't think about anything. I'm standing there, I stepped in mud, and on the way back, I realized like, there wasn't wet ground anywhere around there. Until I realized the dog wandering around peeing on things. So I stepped in mud created by a dog, and that was it was completely gross.
I hope I'm on those moccasins you were.
That was a great story, James.
But it's those kind of things that make a road trip memorable. But now I got to go stop and get a pot to add a different kind of memorable to Amarillo.
Me too.
Let's well, go there,
I was going to say, how you doing over there, Matt? I wanted you to talk about the.
I know Matt. The word.
The tour of the distilleries. You don't have to drink and drive. So you've got a service now outside of Franklin that does that.
Yeah. So that's with Franklin. We're located almost in the dead center of the state, and when the whiskey trail launched, it actually launched from Franklin. So with no exact start or end point of the trail being in the middle, we plant the flag as a de facto starting point and ending point. So if someone was to come stay in Franklin, they're within an hour and a half of over half of all the distilleries and within a 3-hour drive of most of them. And obviously with Heath's being closest and another one, Leaper's Fork Distillery. So with the popularity of the whiskey trail, bourbon trails and things like that, another idea that honestly was kind of the brainchild of Heath's was linking up our whiskey distilleries with our wineries and breweries and things that are around town. And locally, we have what we call our Masters and Makers Trail. So it'll take folks around to check out the distilleries and experience that along with wineries and staying with the music theme. One of those, or it's owned by one of the biggest names in country music, Kix Brooks, and has music involved all the time along with breweries and lets people get around. But to the tour you were talking about, we just partnered with a company called Grayline, which is a transportation company around.
Yeah, know them very well.
And they're doing a black car service to the distilleries, doing kind of dinner and distilleries tours. So they'll pick you up from your hotel, your house, Airbnb, wherever you're staying, take you around to Heath's place, to Leaper's Fork Distillery. You get the tour and tastings there, and then you end with a dinner next door to Heath's place at a restaurant called Circa. They've got to do some great, upscale Southern fare, lots of cocktails made with the stuff from next door, and they take you you get to have all the fun and not think about any of the driving. And right now during COVID, it's fairly limited, size of up to 8, but once we're back to a semi-normal state, their black car service becomes a black van service, and you can do folks of 20 and have a good fun group go around doing that.
To me, that's what makes it more fun, because now you've got the camaraderie of everyone together, people maybe 3 or 4 friends and everyone else you don't, and you can taste a pair. And to me, and that's just going out in general, I like the conversations, I like meeting people, I like talking and going on a group.
Yeah,
like
you do.
Yeah, exactly. Going on a group like that, to me, would really enhance the experience of going on a winery tour, a distillery tour, whatever it is I'm seeking. Because I'm a social
guy. Like the press trip that we went to San Francisco, right? We bought it with the whole group.
it's like most press trips in Franklin, except I'm usually the one driving them around.
I've only been on one.
That's no fun for you doing the driving. You got to participate. So how do people find that?
Well, you're like giving the tour and you're talking while you're driving, right? And over there we have, over here we got.
Yeah, it's visitfranklin.com. It's linked there, dinner and distilleries tours. They can find the Masters and Makers tour, links out to the State Whiskey Trail. And that's the newest tour that has launched within the state, Middleton, Tennessee. There are several others. Similar things like a group called Mint Julep Tours. It's Star Kentucky. They have an outpost in Nashville, and they come down to the Franklin area distilleries and go on down to Jack and have several different tours. And there are multiple companies that get you out and safely seeing the tours and seeing the distilleries.
Well,
sign me up. I'm interested.
Sign us all up.
Oh, y'all too. Yeah.
I wish I had one of those in East Tennessee up there to go around the Smoky Mountains and hit those distilleries and Pigeon Forge and stuff. The traffic in Pigeon Forge, forget it. You want to be staying in Pigeon Forge or Gatlinburg. Right. You don't want to be driving around up there after a couple of shots.
Good things about the distillery tour that Matt and Visit Franklin have worked with the Gray Line on is Leaper's Fork is very rural, and then the roads between here and there are very rural, and Circa is rural, and so you don't have to get into the traffic at all, Nashville, and even some that you get into in Franklin, and you really get to see countryside that you don't get to see very many places. There aren't, Williams County is a beautiful county, you have rolling hills, big open meadows, old barns, cattle farms, horse farms. And the roads between us and Leaper's Fork are just littered with places that are just spectacular to see. And so as much as it is about coming to see us and Lee and enjoying dinner at Sturka, you're going to get to see part of the country that you just don't see everywhere. I mean, it's a good place to live. And I'm spoiled to get out to ride my bike and all those hills and side roads that the tour guys are going to take you down. So it's as much a part of the journey as the distillers and the food.
Well, as a sports rider who's I was in Savannah, Georgia, and driven all over Georgia, and from Knoxville and driven down to Tuscaloosa and all around the state. I'll tell you what, I've seen a lot of that enough to last me a lifetime myself. It's beautiful, but I personally have seen driven down those 2-lane highways in the south and up. So put me on one of those tour buses and let me just drink and merrily make my way around from one distillery to another.
Yeah. It's like a distillery pub crawl, but you're not having to drive or walk.
Exactly. Just like
basically what it is. Yeah.
It is. That's what I'm comparing it to in my mind anyway.
But obviously don't drink and drive, but those roads are phenomenal with the right vehicle to drive through.
Well, I grew up in Texas out in the middle of nowhere, so.
That's why
how nostalgic you sound talking about the bike rides is like how I feel living by the beach on the strand, be able to ride my bike. It's like you really do love where you live, and that's awesome.
Grab a Titan from Titan pickup truck and head out in the country and just driving those roads, and don't need to drive fast, just drive and enjoy, and don't drink and drive, obviously, but
fishtail on the gravel roads or anything. That's all.
Sit on the tailgate and enjoy some Q.
The worst.
Oh,
man. You make it back to Franklin at night for some live music, some great food. Franklin's a great
town. I know. I am totally down for this.
Yeah,
I have to go on a road trip.
Got some good places to catch some music in Franklin from Puckett's Grays on Main.
Absolutely.
Lots of great music venues, and it's we really are spoiled, Matt and I, with music, and you just never know. I've been in Leaper's Fork and had Naomi Judd bring me tea. That's kind of weird, right?
That's pretty cool.
And the musical talent and the depth is just extraordinary. I'm an attorney by training, the law firm I worked at in Nashville had a music row office that did a lot of trademark work. And then there was one of the attorneys there that was really kind of quiet, kept to himself a little bit, unless he had a little whiskey. And then he'd start opening up. And start like that.
We have a friend like that, Kevin.
Yeah, we're those guys. And it turns out he's a studio, violin or fiddle player. He's a member of the Grand Ole Opry. And,
Wow. What?
And so I was in Tampa one night, and these folks were playing at a restaurant, and somebody asked me if I thought they were any good. And I'm like, they couldn't play the Ramada Hen in Nashville. And like, we just get really, it's a lot of critics. We're used to good music.
Yeah. Tough industry. Tough. Yeah. Yeah. Everything.
Well, no, we had the Bleecker Street Blues Band on before, which is right there in Franklin, and they're awesome. And Matt, what was the name of that little house? That's one place I would definitely have to go. What's the name of that house?
It's a little place called Kimbrough's Pickin' Party.
Kimbrough's, yes.
The best house party you've ever stumbled upon.
Yeah, that place is awesome to hear that band in there.
I love how they converted all those houses into bars and stuff. So cool.
That must be a Southern thing. I noticed that in Louisiana a lot too, that there was, you know, places that were at one point a residential house, and now it's just a big bar. And
I think they just got an idea from some other one, and then they're like, hey, we might as well do that.
I think Southerners just like to drink. They like people to come over to their house and drink, so they just said, let's make a bar out of it. That's what I think.
Yeah, and
I think that's what they started.
If you
that's want a really good, we should research mall. This.
You want to go drink in a strip mall, Franklin may not be the place for you. A
strip mall.
I like places like character. Music
in a great place that
Canada, you could get a drink in a strip mall. I don't think they even served that booze in Waco, the nearest mall that, when I grew up in Texas.
Although I will say that is it Fat Melvin's or Melvin's, whatever that dog, the place we had in Irving.
The Louisiana place?
Poe Melvin.
Oh, my God. That guy is hilarious. He's a Cajun that lives in Irving.
Mall, but man,
Cajuns are great. Oh, my gosh. Love it.
So as long as the food's good and the drinks are good, I'll drink and, you know, I'll drink in a garbage dump as long as it doesn't smell too bad. the important thing
same,
is
making sure you got good honestly, food, I guess, you know.
We'll feed you and serve you drinks at world-class places in Franklin instead.
Ooh, you know, up the bar.
I would rather be a nicer place. But at the end of the day, you know, if you don't have good food, if you don't have good drinks, if you don't have good friends, you know, the nicest place in the world with the fanciest seats and the most expensive art on the walls is going to be a pile of shit if you don't have the good stuff, the important stuff. Sure.
Heath, yeah. I've also got this. It's a white. Can you tell what this is by looking at it? Because I have a little
looks like clear liquid, maybe yellow, maybe wine.
Oh, it's the dry gin. Okay.
The dry gin.
Gabby has that one, so I haven't tried that one.
I'm a big gin fan. You know, that's born of a bit of an overindulgence in Wild Turkey back in college. So there was this period of time where I couldn't drink bourbon, and that, you know, I still can't drink turkey. It's not turkey's fault. It's mine.
I had that thing happen with me with Jaeger for a while, too.
I was on a Southwest flight a couple years ago, and, you know, I'm like, bring me some turkey. Neat. And it's just, you don't want to ask me. No. You know.
Did you tell that flight attendant just like that?
Just like that. I was very polite.
Because I'm a flight attendant, so I'm like, excuse me, mister, for your manners.
Yeah, so, you know, bring the turkey and the cup, I pour it in there, I take one sip, I'm like, could I get some ginger ale? I just couldn't do it.
I hear you.
Interim period, started drinking, you know, gin, love martinis. Time in Great Britain really sort of brought that home. And so when we started the distillery, you know, my wife and I spent about 6 months with just botanicals trying to figure out what in the world went into gin. So, you know, instead of starting out with, you know, a bias like, well, we got to have 75 botanicals and some polar bear hair, you know, we started out with more basic questions like, you know, what in the world is juniper berry? So
never heard of it.
You know, and see what they did. And so we ended up isolating about 26 different botanicals, stuff you've heard of, some weird stuff like, you know, bay leaves. I was going to try sassafras a few times. There's only 6 botanicals in our gin. And so there, you know, nothing crazy, no magic berry. It's just juniper, coriander, some citrus, some angelica root, and some pepper. And so, we just really focused on how to maximize flavor with the gin and minimize all the weird stuff because everything gets weird at some point. And so
I think you did a really good job.
It tends to happen.
The nose is probably a little bit too strong for me for sipping, but I think that nose, especially if you added it to some other stuff in a cocktail, it would just be perfect.
Just a little bit of tonic water. We've been drinking some Last Words. Sorry, my quarantine beverage was of choice.
Quarantine beverage. I guess we all have one, right?
Right.
Quarantini.
The quarantine. Yeah.
Quarantini. Yes, that actually is a thing, for sure. I think I got sunscreen in my eyes when I put it on, and now I feel like I've been crying this whole episode.
you were mentioning Wild Turkey a little bit ago. Tom has an interesting story about Wild Turkey. and how he forced them to change their marketing plan. Oh.
What?
Well, you know,
Please tell.
I don't know if I was responsible. I might have been, but you know, they did. They give him the bird for a while, and they actually sent me a. They said they were. You know, the.
Wait a minute. Let's go back. Alt Turkey gave you the bird.
Yeah, you know what?
That was our campaign, the whole multi-million-dollar ad campaign. Give him the bird.
Give me the bird.
So Jimmy Russell.
I mean, that's pretty good marketing, honestly.
Well, they were on the commercial. It was like kind of bleeped out. Can I share an image on my screen? How do I do that?
You
I
can
think
go to
James is the only one that could do that.
No, he can go to share screen the same way you can on
I do it on mine. But basically, give the bird, the whole theme of it was the way you order a wild turkey. This was like 6 or 7 years ago, or 8 maybe, was to, you know, give someone the finger just to say politely, I want a wild turkey. And so, you know, that was their advertising campaign. And they even sent out, you know, those gloves that they give you at baseball games that where you put your finger up like that. They sent one of those out with the, you know, middle finger given. And so when I saw, I'll show you the picture. When I saw Jimmy Russell and Eddie Russell, you know, the Master Stillers, they did this with me. Can you guys see that picture? There it is.
In a minute. Jimmy Russell
and Eddie Russell and myself.
And it looks like y'all are just like,
They all did it with me. You know, Jimmy Russell's part of the reason why Wild Turkey exists. And so basically, about a week after that, I posted that picture because I meant it in love because I love Wild Turkey. The campaign was pulled from
shocking
from Wild Turkey. Now, they still said give me the bird, but they didn't show the middle finger.
They didn't show the middle finger.
So
I mean, you know, it could get a little scrutiny, especially in the South.
Yeah,
and I don't know what actually happened there inside baseball kind of stuff, and we will probably never know. But I actually brought that up to Jimmy and Russell when I met with them a couple years ago.
Wow!
And they kind of looked at each other and laughed, and then just changed the subject. So I think they thought it was hilarious.
They're probably locked that up in a safe and never to be talked about. It's like Voldemort.
I'm the only person that has a picture with him doing that, though. I've looked it around. I'm pretty
sure.
Oh,
you should print it out, frame it.
So I probably should write something about I didn't mean to change the campaign. In fact, I thought it fit really well with the campaign of Wild Turkey.
And to be fair, if the head distiller and he's the owner of Wild Turkey, isn't he, Jimmy?
Well, they're like the faces. They're the distillers. They're big in it. Yeah.
But if those guys like it, you know, I think they, you're okay.
I think it's funny.
We'll see if it ever comes back.
But for those of you who have ever gotten a chance to have dinner or to have a off the record conversation with the distiller. Not the brewers and vintners don't have a sense of humor, but definitely if a distiller ever says like, "Hey, you want to go to dinner? You want to hang out?" Do it because man, I have never heard as good a story as I have at not just Texas, not just California, not just Tennessee. Well, actually, I've never actually hung out with a Tennessee distiller, so maybe the first time coming up soon. But distillers have a sense of humor that's just wicked, and there's a sense of you know, refinement and distilling is a luxury art, but there's a sense of renegade trying to do something different and a weird sense of humor that is really enjoyable if you ever get a chance to get to know one of these guys.
Absolutely.
Well, I know I liked Heath before we ever did the first show because there were emails back and forth where I'm like, I like this guy. He's really cool. I want to hang out with this guy, you know, and I wanted to go to the distillery. Back then, I didn't really at the moment care if the you know, it was good or not, you know, learn out whatever process. It turns out to be good.
Charming, Heath.
And I just want to hang out with that guy because he's fun. I could sit there and, you know, and drink whiskey or whatever he makes or beer or anything with this guy and have a great time. So, and it mixes well, by the way. Diet Pepsi, I know James is laughing at me, but it's a perfect mix.
No, I put it with Coke Zero, like you said, just did a soda. And I'm enjoying it.
It blends perfectly with that. So
really does. Coke Zero is what I got.
If I shiver at the Diet Pepsi mix, it's don't be offended.
Well, the thing is, well, yeah, so you're saying you need more sugar in your drink? I'm saying I like the up and down of like the, you know, caffeine without the sugar and then, you know, you upper and downer here.
But Tom taught me it's not embarrassing to drink a soda, you know, with good bourbon or whiskey, as I said to start the show. So otherwise, yeah, I'd be secretly and not tell anyone.
I know, I missed it. I was actually going to get the soda.
Yeah, it's really good sometimes.
So I was late.
But I don't really know what else to mix with it, you know, so because I'm only learning about bourbon whiskey. So
a lot better.
You know, Tom Collins. Well, not Tom Collins. Tom Collins.
I've never had that before.
What's the one that's more?
I've got ginger ale down here. I should have tried that.
Ginger beer.
Oh, I bet you ginger would take ginger beer or ginger ale.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I should have done
spicier than ginger ale. A little twist of lemon. That's a great summertime cocktail.
Okay.
With any bourbon. Now, I've got a restaurant buddy in town here who has a bottle. He calls it his brother-in-law bottle. And on the label, it says Pappy 15. But what's inside, I think, is Jim Beam. And so he controls
it. Okay, Dr. Seuss.
He's a good brother-in-law, so he can pour it in his Coke.
That's a pretty good trick, actually.
I had a friend when he would have house parties over, he would take a empty bottle of Belvedere and pour pop-off into it. Stop me, girls. I don't know any difference. I'm like, I think some of them would, but some of them wouldn't.
I know I would.
I know. Sure.
My roommate has like these cool little bottles of that looks like I could show it to you, but I'm not going to. But like, it's sort of like coolly balanced. So it's like whiskey and probably a vodka or gin and, but who knows what's in it, really? He says, what? I don't think so.
His name's Greg, and he called his pad the G-spot.
So, we all have some cheesy friends, y'all.
Yeah, that's funny. Yeah, guys have trouble finding a place.
Well, I tell you, that was a good one. About 60 minutes almost now here, but before we head off, I want to make sure, you know, you talked about the Tennessee Whiskey Trail, and obviously everybody has to start in Franklin, and everybody has to go to H Clark.
Stop there.
Where's the end?
And H Clark.
Where's the end? Is it like your
back where you started?
But what is, aside from H Clark, what would you guys each, you know, what would be the one place that you'd have to stop at? And I'm going to exclude Jack Daniels, because I think most people that would do it would obviously make sure they stop at Jack Daniels. But aside from Jack and H. Clark, where should guys absolutely go visit? I'll let Matt, you can go first.
I would start with, I'll give you two. Leaper's Fork Distillery is one I would absolutely say, just for the atmosphere and the experience you'll have there. And it's also in the Franklin area, which it's probably the closest to Heath's place. And then up in Nashville, I would also add a Nelson Greenbrier. Those guys, they have a fantastic story to go along with it. And that's the atmosphere and the story that goes along with the experience is almost just as much fun as the
actual product. That's everything. It really is.
I would add two
more to that list while you're in Middle Tennessee. If you're in Nashville area, stop by and see Corsair or the Nashville Craft. And so they're very close together. And they do some pretty, they're pushing, the folks at Corsair are pushing the envelope on different types of spirits. And then Nashville Craft is doing the same things for unique Tennessee produced spirits. And, you know, I'm not an absinthe fan. In fact, I sort of hate it. But Nashville Craft produces an absinthe that's pretty good. Yeah.
Oh, what kind of absinthe?
I mean, every now and then, one shot. Yeah.
Oh, I got into my grandma's candy, you know, drawer as a kid and got a bag of licorice. And
I love licorice.
Yeah.
Tom and I had some.
If I had some, you could have all of it because I cannot.
You either love or you hate it. Yeah. That's how I figured it out.
I've got this bowl of things I've overindulged in that are no longer available to me. And wild turkey's in there, licorice is in there, you know.
I blame my dad. He got me on them. Like, the black licorice and the whistlers.
Did you say Woodford's on your list too?
No, 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 not Woodford. No, not yet.
I would recommend East Tennessee, being from East Tennessee, up around Gatlinburg, Sevierville, Pigeon Forge. And Heath, is there a, I saw there was an old mill distillery, and in an area of East Tennessee in the mountains, there's the old mill grist mill where they actually used to make. And it's not there because that's along the Cave's Cove Loop Trail, which I love biking on. It's right, the beautiful, beautiful area. And the old mill was where they actually used to make the mill, you know, like the corn mill. And they have the trough of the water going and the, you know, spinning by the water. But that's, there's not a distillery there, right? They just
there is. That's actually Old Forge Distillery. The Christian part of it. Yeah.
Wow.
There's a Cave's Cove next door to the old mill. There's a great restaurant in there. So you get a big, you know, big country breakfast. And
I would recommend that then, because that's scenery.
Yeah. And I agree on the Corsair is amazing, and the other ones mentioned Nelson's Greenbrier. I really love what Alex Castle's done there at Old Dominic. I get to Memphis a few times a year too. So many great places, though. I mean, there's just so much, and I love discovering new ones. We're gonna have to come visit you, Heath, at H Clark. I would love to
see
what we're doing there.
Oh, you know, we didn't mention too. We didn't mention Corey from Peg Leg.
Oh yeah, Peg Leg. It has an amazing bourbon there, and definitely visit his place in the Gulch for the barbecue and try the bourbon. He's such a character. He's so much fun.
Where exactly is he located?
He's in the Gulch in Nashville.
Nashville. Oh, okay. I don't know what the Gulch means. My parents lived in South Haven for 9 years, and my brother still lives there, so I do actually fly into Memphis a lot. My phone number is 901, area code, actually. Memphis, but I'm just I've never heard Gulch before.
If you're out driving south, you know, don't forget George Dickel Distillery. Those guys, their bond whiskey was the 2019 Whiskey of the Year, according from Whiskey Advocate magazine. So get some world-class spirits all over Middle and East Tennessee.
So can you real quick clarify the bourbon versus whiskey? Does the whiskey, is it charcoal filter? Because when I saw Tennessee bourbon, I was like, wait a minute. I thought Tennessee was all whiskey.
So it's a bit of a, being an attorney, I sort of get into definitions more than some people.
Well, we're a good person to ask then.
So Tennessee whiskey technically meets the federal definition of bourbon. There's a letter from the TTB to Lynn Motlow that simply says that Tennessee whiskey is not bourbon. And so what it is Tennessee distillers like Jack Daniels and George Dickel, they make a mash and a process that's essentially bourbon. But before they barrel the whiskey, they filter the spirit through a sugar maple charcoal, and then they barrel it. And so that dripping through the charcoal is the mellowing that you hear about. And that's the distinction between bourbon and Tennessee whiskey. What's even more fascinating about that technology, if you will, is as you know, if you're familiar with the story of Uncle Nearest, you may have heard that, where Uncle Nearest was a freed slave who, taught Jack Daniels how to distill. The charcoal mellowing technology was likely brought over with enslaved Africans, and so this was a technology available to the folks in Africa to clean up their drinking water. So they would make charcoal.
Oh, okay, I never heard that.
I've never heard that either.
The distillate probably coming off of the stills back before there were, you know, it was probably open fire wood under the, you know, so you're going to have some pretty tough, your fermentation is not going to be consistent. So the distillate
makes complete sense. And that's impressive.
And so if you can't go buy activated carbon, you had to make your own. And so, the story of Tennessee whiskey is a real story that at its core was probably amplified. The traditions are not just, from the whiskey makers from Pennsylvania, New York, in a large way, were enslaved Africans who did a lot of the heavy lifting on distillation in the South for hundreds of years.
Do you have contacts with Uncle Nier? Because I've tried contacting them a couple times, and I've gotten nothing, no response back from their contact us on the website. But I'd love to have them on the show because I think they have a phenomenal story that, I didn't even know how, as deep as it was as far as the heritage. I just thought that it happened to be a former slave that liked to distill. I didn't realize it actually went back to African traditions.
Yeah, so there's a rich story there and a lot to tell. Fawn Weaver, she's sort of found that brand. I'd be happy to give her your contact information. I'm probably not going to hand out hers,
that's fine. I just
I'm very curious too.
I think that they have a really unique story that probably most people don't know. I mean, I think the more modern aspect of distilling, there's a lot of people who have kind of a very similar story, but theirs is radically different than pretty much anybody that I've heard of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, it's I'm glad she's telling the story because it's a part of our history that's not always pleasant, you know. And so, might as well face it head on and celebrate the good that sort of results from lots of tough decisions back in the day. So, and whiskey's one of them.
Whiskey and barbecue and music. I mean, I think
I think
a lot
blues,
of
blues. There's so many things that came out of that.
Where the heritage came from, but I mean, even Elvis. I mean, Elvis is probably one of the whitest white guys you think of if you look at him and think of the later years. But yeah, he got his start singing in predominantly African churches and. Kind of blending some of the traditions, making them palatable to a white audience. So, I love talking about kind of where things have come. And at the end of the day, if it's good music, it's good barbecue, it's good whiskey,
then it's a good time.
There's
back
no
to that. You're like good food. Doesn't matter where it's at, right? Good food, good music, good booze.
Well, let me give a shout out to Chef Dion, who had his birthday yesterday.
Dion!
Happy birthday, Dion.
Happy birthday, Dion.
Just happy birthday. Just joined in now as Yvette. She knows all. There's Woo! Dion. Hey.
Hi, Dion.
Yvette's watching. She's one of our South Bay friends. There she is. Cheers. She's very excited for the start of baseball season because she's a huge Dodger fan.
Boo.
Oh. Hey, the Padres may win it all this year. They may only play 10 games.
Got a good Franklin guy on the roster with Mookie Betts.
Hey, there you go.
Hi, Ben. Hey, I am going to give a shout out. So Dion is a sushi chef at the Boat Sushi and Thai in El Segundo. So if you live, or you're watching and you live in the area, definitely check it out. He literally taught me how to make sushi. He's ridiculously good. We're checking out.
He brings out that flame thing sometimes, and how we.
Oh my gosh! I'll have to show you pictures later. I learned how to make roll the rice and the. Oh my god! There's just so many steps. We went to this little fish market. It was like an Asian little fish market. I'm just telling you, it was an exciting experience. I think actually he does do one-on-one, But it was really awesome.
Well, Matt, what's going on in Franklin now? Nothing's going on anywhere, but let's just say golf courses are open or something, right? What's what's going on around Franklin now?
Well, we do have some golf courses open, and that's like a lot of the rest of the country.
Woo,
in the travel world, a lot of events have been canceled, and staying in the whiskey theme, where we're home to a couple really sizable whiskey events each year, and unfortunately the most recent one,
they're all been canceled.
Coming up on August 1st has been canceled as well, but it's one called the Southern Whiskey Society, and it brings distillers from across Tennessee, and they'll allow some of the friends from Kentucky to come down for it too.
What?
It's not
East Tennessee, so there won't be a lot of this.
No,
Kentucky guys can bring their money.
Yeah, but it pairs a
They're welcome with their money, right?
Yeah, it pairs me probably 30 different distilleries, showing some samples off, and sometimes previewing things for the first time to the public, and then they sprinkle in 10 world class chefs from around the South too. So it's a really fun events each year for good food and good whiskey and bourbon. But Franklin as a whole, you know, it's where you're going to come. You'll find a classic southern town, a main street that's kind of known worldwide. As kind of picture your classic, you know, Norman Rockwell painting of a you know, Americana main street. Franklin is that in real life, plus being a corporate hub in the business district. So we've got all the, you know, everything you can kind of imagine from amenity wise, plus you can put your phone away, just kind of walk down the street and breathe deeply, walk a little slower and relax a little bit all while here.
Phone away. There's a lot of young, fun people that live there too. A lot of single people. Let's not discount that. There, and you're going to have the phone out taking pictures and Instagramming and all this
stuff. Where exactly?
So,
where exactly are you located?
15 miles south of downtown Nashville.
Okay. What's funny, I'm from Texas, so I get that. But maybe other people might not.
Yeah, that's
you're beautiful town.
Let's not just count Franklin as a good place for our single people. There's a lot of there's Lonely Planet, there's Nissan, there's you know, a lot of people don't want to live in Nashville. A lot of young single people.
Yeah, we
can live in Franklin a little bit away.
Why would you want to live in
Franklin?
Probably can't afford it. Just kind of like LA.
Yeah.
Well, I will say most all those names that make Nashville famous actually live down in Franklin. So it's a place where, you know, your songwriter playing the lunch hour.
Yeah.
I'm not being facetious when I say there's a couple of those that have Grammys that are playing lunch hour.
And those horse farms.
No, I get it.
And there's you know, bourbon whiskey, so it's kind of it's almost like you almost shut your eyes and think you're in Kentucky. But you're
it's like people in from Hawaii don't want to live in Waikiki. You know what I'm saying? They want to be away from the tourist trap.
We're obviously located very closely to Nashville, and we play fantastically nicely.
Well, it sounds awesome. I can't wait to go and visit Franklin.
Absolutely.
Well, guys, make sure you go to visitfranklin.com, check out more stuff, and obviously you can find more questions and answers and all that kind of fun stuff on their social media too. But definitely thank you, Matt, for joining us. Sorry that we had a kind of weird first go around a few weeks ago, but I'm thrilled that you gave us a second chance. And Heath, I'm glad you sent us these bottles. The only bad part
thank
is I know
you.
That Kevin's gonna come over here and want some more. So I will oblige because they are definitely worth sharing.
Yeah, if you're on the West Coast in California, so there's a company called LibDib, and they are kind of a virtual distributor, and they allow us to ship into California, New York, Florida. And so we've done a little bit of that. So if you're in any of those states and have a favorite liquor store, just reach out. I'll be happy to get you the information so they can bring us into market.
Very cool.
Awesome.
It's good stuff. He's a good man. Everyone, good old Tennessee, Tom. You're looking in from Indiana through Kentucky, so thanks for joining us.
We are close by. I'm going to pour a little bit more. One I forgot to mention that I like is King's family distillery as well, Justin King's place there and his wife. So I'm going to pour a little of this as we end. And I love what you guys do in Tennessee. I really do.
One last toast. And Heath or Matt, do you want to lead? Who wants to lead the toast?
Better let Heath. My glass is empty, so better let Heath do it.
Let me find the camera. I'm getting a refill here. Cheers.
Right. Plenty of time for refill.
I love that your glass is so, like, we wouldn't even know, but you're so honest that you... I love that. That's
you mentioned characteristic. You mentioned NASCAR earlier. I've gone to my backup car here. So I'm
there we go. I like it. Well, guys, let's have a toast to whiskey and when we can get out and visit in person.
It's still happening, man. Totally.
Cheers.
We will see you all in Franklin.
Yeah. Absolutely.
H Clark Distillery.
Come on down. We look forward to having you.
Cheers. Thanks, Laura.
Cheers, Laura. Love you.